so much to the choir. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your singing. We certainly appreciate all of you who are here tonight. And thank you, Melody, also for the solo that you just sang. And thank you to Stephen Ricker for all that he has done to make this possible. And for Dr. Quick, both in helping with the planning of the conference and playing the piano for us sometimes. And thank you to each of the men who have spoken so articulately on the incredible theme that we have for our conference, I Am Set, for the defense of the gospel. Let's all give a round of applause for all of these who have done so much for us.
Central element of the gospel
resurrection. There is, of course, no resurrection if there is no death, so Christ would have to die according to the Scriptures. But, you know, all men die. So the unique element of the gospel is that Christ not only died, but that he rose again, which makes the application of the gospel for our sins. That's what makes it possible. Without the resurrection, we have no better hope than the pagan cultists, the false religionists, whose leaders are still dead. Not only did Christ rise again, but his resurrection was specifically prophesied in the Scriptures of the Old Testament. They were written centuries before he was even born, and it followed a specific timetable. Not a moment too soon, not a moment late. Paul clearly restates the elements of the gospel in Romans chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, same thing that he said in 1 Corinthians 15. Concerning, what's the gospel about? Concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David, there's his humanity, according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. Notice Paul's emphasis on the Scriptures, both in Romans 1 and in 1 Corinthians 15. His emphasis is not on tradition, or reason, or personal experience, or emotional feelings, Jewish mythology, wishful thinking, visions and dreams, charismatic manifestations. It's not based on church councils, or papal dogma, or decrees, or hallucinations produced by psychedelic mushrooms. We are people of the book. The Bible is our final authority. Without the Scriptures, we end up throwing ourselves back into the book of Judges, where every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Now let me pause for just a moment to talk about several key words in our text in Galatians. First, we need to look at the word another in the phrase another gospel in verse 6. And then we see a different word in verse 7, which is not another. Another gospel, which is not another. In Greek, there are two different words translated another. The first another in verse 6 is the word heteros, which means another of a different kind. The second word is allos in verse 7, which means another of the same kind. And so the Apostle Paul is plainly saying that the apostates preach a different kind of gospel, not another gospel of the same kind that he preached. We find the word heteros, which is another of a different kind, in such English words as heterodoxy, which is an unorthodox or heretical belief outside of the realm of genuine orthodoxy. We see the Greek word and the English word heterosexual, indicating that there are two different sexes, male and female, and certainly only two in the eyes of God. No matter what other people are talking about these days, all these other man-made forms of so-called gender manipulation are an abomination to God, although they are gaining in popularity and ascendancy. In our text, Paul is emphasizing that there existed, even in the apostolic period, pseudo-gospels of a different kind, and thus they were contrary to the true gospel. He then goes on to describe the gospel perversions. The next term, which is gospel, means, as you know, good news, so we'll not spend much time talking about its etymology, as we have done with another, but it's it's the center of our discussion. What is the good news? Finally, we pause to look at the word Christ, which Paul uses both in Romans chapter 1 and in 1 Corinthians 15 to describe the Lord Jesus in the context of the gospel. Christ is Christos in the Greek New Testament. And that's the equivalent of Messiah, Mashiach, in the Hebrew Old Testament. Both of those words mean the anointed one. In short, to have the Christ of Scriptures, you must know the Messiah prophesied in the Old Testament. That, of course, is an exciting study in and of itself, but we can only briefly touch on it here in relation to the gospel. But the Christ, or Messiah, described in the Old Testament is both God, undiminished God, and sinless, perfect man. There are many Old Testament passages where we see that the promised Messiah will be both God and man, but perhaps two familiar ones will suffice. We see his sinless humanity portrayed for us, for example, in Isaiah 53, a very interesting passage because it is so clearly pointing to Jesus that many Jewish rabbis do not allow their people to read Isaiah 53 in their own language. They read it, they have it in Hebrew in their Bibles, but in the English Jewish Bibles in some synagogues, they don't even translate Isaiah 53 because when a Jew reads that, he suddenly realizes that's the Jesus that the Christians are talking about. Isaiah 53 very clearly portrays the Lord Jesus Christ, a Messiah who is clearly human and capable of dying. We see not only his humanity, but his absolute, undiminished deity in the famous passage in Micah chapter 5 and verse 2. You're all familiar with that passage because it's quoted by the Jewish leaders to Herod when Herod demanded where Christ, that is the Messiah, would be born. But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me that is to be ruler in Israel. And the rabbis talking to Herod stopped there, but listen to the rest of the verse. Whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting. The fact that he was born in Bethlehem certainly indicates his humanity, but the final statement, that final phrase, is a clear statement of his deity. Whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting. That phrase is one of the phrases used in the Psalms to declare the eternal, uncreated pre-existence of Jehovah, the covenant God of Israel. The word translated old is kedem. It means ancient, antiquity, aforetime, eternal. Surprisingly, it's used of a baby in Micah 5:2. The word translated everlasting is olam. It means eternity. The Messiah to be born in Bethlehem was already in existence from ancient times, from the eternal, everlasting past. The pre-incarnate Christ, as described in John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. In Psalm 92, we see both words used of God. And when we compare this psalm with other portions of the Old Testament scriptures and the book of Revelation, it becomes apparent that this psalm is speaking about Jesus. Psalm 93:2 says, "Thy throne is established of old, thou art from everlasting." In other words, the gospel of salvation that Paul defended in Galatians 1:6-9 has specific content. It speaks of a very specific, very literal Messiah who is both undiminished God and perfect, sinless man. The gospel that Paul defended is not an amorphous, fuzzy, feel-good emotion, charismatic experience, being slain in the spirit, speaking in tongues, feeling the force, neo-evangelical rock band hysteria, mystical Roman Catholic apparitions of Mary or Jesus, accumulation of rosary merit, avoidance of cardinal and venial sins, or slavish obedience to the Mosaic law. No. The gospel that Paul preached is the concrete set of divinely revealed and irrefutably proven facts, a declaration of good news concerning a clearly articulated, supernaturally accomplished entrance at a precise point in human history of the God-man who died for our sins and rose bodily from the dead in precise accord with literal prophecy concerning the specific, clearly defined, one and only Savior without whom there is no salvation. Anyone who does not preach that gospel is cursed by God. To make sure that we do not miss the point, the Apostle Paul states it twice. In verse 9, as we said before, so say I now again. If any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. It's also significant that Paul lists angelic beings as those who might communicate a false gospel. Because there are many groups today who claim to have received new revelation from angelic beings. The Mormons claim that they got new revelation and a so-called gospel from the angel Moroni. Roman Catholic history is full of apparitions giving directions to faithful Catholics. The charismatic movement, which is drawing many apostate denominations together for the ultimate one world church, is specifically known for its visions, its dreams, its signs and wonders, almost all of which follow the practices of the demonic occult by using demonic means to induce these experiences. Islam is no exception. Muhammad himself had a spirit guide as he sat in the cave on Mount Hira, where he claimed that the angel Gabriel grabbed him by the throat and commanded him to repeat the sacred words. Buddha was sitting under the Bo tree when the serpent appeared to him and gave him enlightenment. Multiple religions around the world have traditions of supernatural beings appearing and giving wisdom or divine revelation. Even aficionados of the alien invasion theory get theological messages from space aliens. A number of years ago, Clifford A. Wilson, who is a trained professional archaeologist, made a study of the messages that were being transmitted by aliens in his book, Crash Go the Chariots. That was 1972. A response to Eric von Daniken's book, Chariots of the Gods, in 1968. Von Daniken claimed that the ancient archaeological ruins, which you have some of them here in Mexico to which this is referring, that these ruins proved that we had been visited by space aliens in the remote past. Wilson, a Christian archaeologist and a creationist, demonstrates the scientific foolishness of von Daniken's theory. He also wrote a follow-up book entitled The Chariots Still Go Crash, 1976, with more rebuttals to von Daniken, pointing out a demonic connection. Did you know that a surprising number of the space alien messages include things that question the Bible, cast doubt on the inspiration of Scripture, deny original sin, deny a future judgment, deny the need for a sinless Savior Messiah to forgive them, deny the deity of Christ, deny the virgin birth, and deny many other key Bible doctrines? Why would space aliens come billions of miles to tell people that Jesus isn't God? That's not space aliens, people. More recently, Gary Bates, the CEO of Creation Ministries International, has published a book called Alien Invasion, with updated information on the demonic nature of so-called space aliens. They've also produced 4 separate DVDs on the subject, with interviews exploring the nature of so-called UFOs and related supernatural and psychic phenomena. They say, why are you preaching about that tonight? What's important in the context of another gospel? I'll tell you the reason. Satan always uses whatever is available for him. We see that with the other cults whom we recognize. But do you know that thousands of new Christians and Christian young people have been caught up or are being caught up in what has been called UFOlogy? It's just below the surface. It's off the radar of most Bible-believing churches. But there is an entire alien invasion subculture in the developed nations of the world based on new revelation and another gospel. Listen carefully. One of the targets of this new gospel are the young people in your church. It involves the doctrine of demons. Are you prepared to answer this other gospel? Do you know how to answer young people when they say, well, but so-and-so saw this? They're close encounters of 4 different kinds. We'll not go through those tonight. Or they were taken up in one of the spaceships. I heard their testimony. It really sounds real. Do you know how to answer them? That's another gospel that is being preached and is permeating Christian churches, including fundamental Bible churches, where the young people are hearing this from their friends at school. Do they know how to answer it? What can you say? Careful study shows that this subculture is also moving. Just like Roman Catholicism and these ecumenical councils, this subculture is also moving toward a one-world entity in preparation for the Antichrist. In the more traditional deviant gospels, groups like the Mormons and certain charismatic groups claim that they have living apostles. The Catholics claim that the Vatican is the apostolic see, that is, seat, and that the Pope has inherited the keys of the kingdom from the Apostle Peter. Church dogma declares that when the Pope speaks ex cathedra, that's an official pronouncement from the papal throne, that his words have the same authority, the same accuracy, the same reliability, and the same inerrancy as Scripture. Paul answers such claims bluntly and forcefully. 2 Corinthians 11, beginning in verse 13. For there are such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. Not a pleasant future for the apostates. In a nutshell, the gospel is not something that man must do to be saved. The gospel is the good news that God has already done what man cannot do. The good news is not that you must work for your salvation, but that Jesus Christ has already done all the work that is necessary to make you acceptable to God. In its simplest form, the gospel centers on 4 key elements related to the person and work of Christ. Under the heading of his person, number 1, he is undiminished God, and number 2, he is perfect, sinless man. That's his person. Under the heading of his work, he died for our sins and he bodily rose from the dead. All 4 elements are according to the scriptures, which Paul says twice there in 1 Corinthians 15. Anything contrary to the revealed word of God is another gospel. Let's talk about it. First, his person, that he is undiminished God, fully possessed of all of the divine attributes. It's stated for us clearly in Colossians 2:9. For in him, that is in Jesus Christ, in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. The context of that declaration, like our passage in Galatians, is a warning to the church at Colossae not to be deceived by one who is not the Christ of Scriptures. From the very beginning of the early church, there have been other gospels, such as those presented in the Gnostic Gospel of Thomas or the Gospel of Judas. Gnosticism was rampant in the early church, but these are all frauds and deceptions. And that's why the Apostle Paul writes in verse 4, Colossians 2, "And this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. For though I be absent in the flesh, and I'm with you in the spirit, joining and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ, as ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him." Now listen to verse 7. "Rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, as ye have been taught." The faith refers to a specific body of truth given to the church by the Holy Spirit as he inspired the writing of the New Testament, a specific body of truth concerning who Jesus is and what he did, abounding therein with thanksgiving. And then he says in verse 8, "Beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily." Moving to verse 16, we read the continued warning of false gospels that cover many different elements that are attractive to the flesh, but they lead to an insufficient view of the finished work of Christ. What does he warn about in the very next few verses? "Let no man therefore judge you in meat, or in drink, or in respect of an holy day, or of the new moon, or of the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ." And then he warns again about angels. "Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind," the carnal mind. Oh, how it loves to have exciting experiences. "And not holding the head, from which all the body by joints and bands, having nourishment ministered and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God." When Paul places a curse on anyone who preaches another gospel, it clearly includes those who are trying to put believers back under the Old Testament law, either for salvation or for sanctification. That's the principal point of the whole book of Galatians, which is our context. It's also the context of the passage in Colossians, which we just quoted. But Paul also mentions in verse 18 angelic beings, in this case demons impersonating angels of light, as in 2 Corinthians 11:14. Ultimately, heterodox gospels trace back to demonic doctrine working with the old sin nature, that's what's called the fleshly mind here in this passage, producing pride in the one denying the truth. And it should be noted that a gospel of law-keeping as a means of salvation or sanctification always leads to pride in the one who thinks that he or she has kept the law and on that basis is acceptable to God. That's why Paul tells us, "All have sinned and come short of the glory of God." You cannot keep the law. The law condemns you. The law shows the righteousness of God. The law shows the holiness of God, and that you cannot keep it. That's why you need Jesus. He alone could keep the law, for he was perfect, sinless man, as well as being God himself. Biblically, legalism is when someone tries to put you back under the law, either the law of Moses or the law of man-made rules, to obtain salvation or sanctification. Not being under the law does not mean that God has no standards. People say, "Oh, not under the law, that means God has no standards." No, that's not what we're saying. But rather, that God's standards are not a means of being saved or sanctified. their points of obedience as we grow in grace, and like obedient children, we're motivated to do what the Father wants us to do because we love Him. It's not law that keeps us obeying the Father. It's our love for Him because of what He's done for us. Think about it this way. Have you ever considered that a curse similar to Galatians 1 is on those people who do not love Christ? Did you know that when God looks at us, He doesn't look at shades of gray? With God, everything is black or white. You cannot be neutral, especially about Jesus. Either you are for Him or you are against Him. Jesus said so Himself. You can know about the Christ of Scriptures, but not love Him. Listen to what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 16, verses 22 and 23. If any man love not the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be anathema. That's a curse. And then he says, Maranatha. And goes back to the grace of Christ in verse 23. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. An anathema is a curse. I hear it sometimes in when you're talking up here, the Spanish word is very similar to this, I think. But Maranatha is a declaration that Christ is coming. Just like Paul declares a curse on those who have a different Jesus, so he pronounces a curse on those who don't love the Lord Jesus Christ. Both anathema and Maranatha are essential to his benediction of grace in verse 23. That means that not only is there a technical issue, a different gospel, a different Jesus, a different spirit, but there is also the question of our love response to Jesus Christ, what proves what we really believe about Him, about His person and work. Here's something you really should make as a bottom line principle. What you really believe will always affect what you do. Let me say it again. What you really believe in your heart will affect what you do. You cannot be neutral. Either you love Christ or you do not. There is no middle ground. As an aside, Jesus himself also focused on this issue of love choices in different words in John 3. You all know John 3:16, but have you considered verses 18 and 19? It's a love issue here. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already. You can't be halfway. Because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation. Now listen, because it's going to be an issue of what do you love. That light is come into the world, and men loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. What do you love? If you love Jesus, it will change your life. If you love darkness, you'll try to stay in the gray areas which in God's eyes do not exist. While it is true that the life of a true believer will be transformed day by day as the Spirit of God conforms him or her to the image of Christ, that is never a means of salvation or sanctification. It is the result, not the means. Neither salvation nor sanctification are the work of man. Both salvation and sanctification are the work of God. We all hold firmly to the doctrine of justification by faith alone. But sanctification is also permanently linked to faith and not works. In standing before King Agrippa, Paul recounts his experience on the Damascus Road and states that Jesus commissioned him to preach the gospel, and here I'm quoting Acts 26:18, to preach the gospel, to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God. These are all completely separate opposites, that they may receive forgiveness of sins, and now listen to the last phrase, and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me, Jesus speaking that. What was revealed to Paul? Sanctification is by faith as well as justification. I see our time is moving quickly. Element one of the deity of Christ is seen repeatedly in both the Old and New Testaments. I'm going to give you a list of things. I will not read all of the passages of Scripture, but I'm going to tell you where do we see the deity of Christ repeatedly in both the Old and New Testaments of Scriptures. We see it in the prologue of the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 1 to 18, which parallels Genesis 1. Jesus is seen as the Creator. He is also portrayed as the Creator in Hebrews 1, 1 through 14, where Jesus is called God in verse 8. Jesus is called God in Hebrews 1, 8. And multiple passages from the Old Testament are cited to prove his superiority to the angels and his position as sitting at the right hand of the Father. That's all in Hebrews 1. I'm emphasizing Hebrews because I have a very important story that only happened 2 weeks ago, where in a fundamental church, well, I'll wait till we get there, 1 Timothy 3:16 tells us that God was manifest in the flesh. Jesus himself declared, "He that hath seen me hath seen the Father," John 14, 9, and stated, "Before Abraham was, I am," John 8, 58, a reference to God telling Moses his name at the burning bush in Exodus 3, 13 and 14. "I am that I am hath sent thee unto thee. Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto thee." The Jews certainly understood that this was the claim that Jesus was making, because when he said it, they took up stones to stone him for blasphemy. Jesus is called Almighty, a reference to God in Revelation 1:8. Paul writes that he is able to subdue all things unto himself in Philippians 3:21. Thomas declared about Jesus, "My Lord and my God," in John 20:28. His divine omnipresence is seen in the promise that where two or three are gathered together in his name, he would be in the midst of them, Matthew 18:20, and that he would be with every believer always, Matthew 28:20. Not only did he create all things, John 1:1, but he preserves all things, Colossians 1:16 and Hebrews 1:3. He has attributes that can only be ascribed to God. He pardons sin. He raises the dead. He presides at the judgment seat to dispense rewards to believers, 2 Corinthians 5:10. He judges the unregenerate world at the great white throne judgment, John 5:22. Compare that with Revelation 20, verse 12. He accepts worship, which no angel or other creature is ever permitted to do. Revelation 22, 8 and 9 makes that clear. He accepts worship. The wise men worshiped him. The lepers worshiped him. The women worshiped him. The rulers worshiped him. The disciples worshiped him. Men worshiped him. I've got scripture references on all of these. We don't have time to read them all tonight. So to recapitulate, in its simplest form, the gospel centers on the key elements of the person and work of Christ. The first essential element dealing with the person of Christ is the Christ of Scripture, who is the center of the true gospel, is undiminished God, fully possessed of all the divine attributes. That brings us to the second element of the person of Christ, the fact that he is sinless, perfect man. It should be self-evident that if Jesus is not God, he cannot give you eternal salvation. But if he's not true man, he could not shed his blood for our sins. Element two of his person, which is often denied by those who are cursed, is that he is sinless, perfect man. If Jesus was not sinless, he would have had to have died for his own sins and could not have died as a substitute for other sinners. There are many passages of Scripture that state that Jesus Christ was not a sinner, either by his nature or by choice. He had a sinless nature from the moment of conception. He never had a sinful act, never a sinful thought, never a sinful word, never a sinful motive, never a sinful attitude. He always perfectly reflected the Heavenly Father. For example, in the great reconciliation passage in 2 Corinthians 5:18 through 21, verse 21 states, "For he hath made him," that is Jesus, "to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." Mrs. Buer sang about that tonight. Jesus even challenged his enemies to point out any sin in his life. In John 8, 46, "Which of you convinceth me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do not ye believe me?" Perhaps you're also aware that the sinlessness of Christ is one of the key issues in the other gospels preached by apostates whom Paul curses. The bottom line is not merely the question of whether or not Jesus ever sinned, because the scripture states categorically that he did not sin. Rather, the theological debate, historically, has been around two Latin phrases, posse non peccare or non posse peccare. Was Jesus able not to sin, or was Jesus not able to sin? The answer to that question, and why it has been debated for so long, is it has deep implications on the sinless humanity of Christ, the Christ of the gospel. Hundreds of books have been written on this subject, but in its simplest form, it boils down to a question. Can God sin because Jesus is God? If Jesus was able to sin, this not only brings the nature of God into question, but also brings another horrifying thought. Since Jesus Christ is, Hebrews 13:8, I'm quoting, since Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever, that would mean that Jesus Christ could still sin in heaven, and the believer's position and standing in Christ would never be secure. To answer these issues fully, one must delve into the essential nature of what theologically, and we're not going to talk about that in detail tonight, but what's called the hypostatic union. The fact that Jesus Christ is one person with two distinct natures. But those two natures are so welded together that they can never be separated. That's a rather important understanding to have. I'd like to illustrate this by picturing a giant steel girder that's used to hold up skyscrapers. Some of you have seen these gigantic beams. They're the ones that are underneath railroad trestles. They're like 6 feet tall. They're an inch or two thick, have big T crossbars on the top and on the bottom like this, and multiple ones, huge beams. So we start off with a giant steel girder, and then a straight piece of wire, a little tiny piece of wire. By itself, you cannot bend the steel girder, but you can easily bend the wire with your bare hands. However, if you weld that wire for its entire length to the steel girder, and then I ask you to bend the wire, you cannot do it even if you exert your full strength. Even so it is with Christ. The steel girder is the deity of Christ. The straight wire is his sinless humanity. It's interesting that Paul calls Jesus the second Adam, the one who accomplished what the first Adam could not. The first Adam was sinless at creation and in that sense perfect. But he did in fact sin, and the resulting fall is what has brought about our current estate. The first Adam was the wire without the steel girder. Where the confusion lies is with the phrase that Jesus Christ was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Hebrews 4:15. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Those who challenge the doctrine that Christ could not sin, they're challenging that. They point to that verse and they say, but it says that he was tempted. This begins with a false premise. They assume that being tempted means that there is proclivity, a natural desire to sin, and to some degree an internal attraction to sin, which would of course be in of itself sin. But the temptation is not the sin. Although we, who are often tempted and fall, have gotten used to associating the temptation and the sin so closely that in our own rotten experience, the terms seem synonymous. But there's a clear distinction. The temptation is the attack against the fortress, not the fall of the fortress. For example, here's one we'll all understand. Suppose a band of Apache Indians have surrounded a wooden fort out on the Great Plains of the United States back in the 1800s. They circle the fort, screaming and yelling and firing their rifles and their arrows. The defenders fire back. It's not certain whether or not the fort will fall or not, because many forts did fall as the Indians shot their flaming arrows. The forts burned to the ground. It was a genuine attack. It was a genuine fall. Now, imagine the same band of Apaches in the early 1800s attacking a solid steel fortress, 1,000 feet high, 200 feet thick, with a steel foundation that goes down 500 feet below the ground. Oh, and it's also electrically charged with death-dealing power, so that anybody who touches it will be fried to a crisp. Got the idea? Pretty impregnable fortress. The only access to the interior of the fort is by helicopter. And there is enough food and water to last the people inside 10,000 years. So the Indians scream and yell just as loudly as they did before. They fire their guns, they shoot their arrows with just as much ferocity. They ride their horses just as fast. They jump off their horses and bang on the steel wall with their stone tomahawks. It's a genuine attack, just like the first scenario, but is an utterly impossible, doomed attack. Will they ever get in? No. Are the people inside safe? Yes. An attack can come without a resulting fall. Satan clearly tempted Christ in Matthew 4. Satan attacked Jesus with every major area of temptation by which he had attacked Adam and every succeeding generation. It was a real attack, not a practice drill. It was a genuine attack, even if there was no possibility of conquest. But Jesus never sinned. He was in all points tempted, like as we are, yet without sin. Jesus also gave each one of us the way to deal with an attack by the devil. Jesus answered the devil with scripture. That's important. Jesus could have made it up and said anything that he wanted, and he would have defeated the devil, because the words of Jesus would always be scripture. He's God. But what Jesus did was he quoted the Old Testament. He quoted the Bible to show us how to deal with Satan's attacks when we are tempted. So remember, the attack is the temptation. The yielding is the sin. Only if Jesus Christ was sinless man could he offer himself to die in our place and give us salvation. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. But there's a caveat. The devil doesn't always make a frontal attack on the person and work of Christ. The heart of Paul's gospel in Galatians 1, 6 through 9. Sometimes the attack is indirect by undermining key passages of scripture, such as those multiple passages in Hebrews that we just read. Remember I said pay attention to the Hebrews passages. That means you have to teach your people to fully trust the Bible. You must insist on its reliability. Satan will attack the Bible because it is the only offensive weapon given to the Christian to defeat the devil. When you read Ephesians 6, it talks about the spiritual war and the armor of God. All of the armor is protective. Only the sword is offensive, where you can go on the attack yourself. Everything else is just to defend. Hebrews makes other statements about the sinlessness of the humanity of Christ. For such an high priest became us who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. Verses 25 through 28 put this in the context of our eternal salvation and fully bases that salvation on that statement of his sinlessness. Remember, we're talking about false gospels in this message. Let me show you in real life how an attack by Satan on the written word of God is an attack on Jesus Christ, the living word of God, and thus an attack on the heart of the true gospel. We just read a bunch of verses in Hebrews that are significant concerning the sinlessness of Christ. Satan likes to attack any portion of scripture that presents the Bible, the biblical Jesus, clearly. Since we've just looked at those passages in Hebrews, let me give you a recent real-life illustration of how this denial, which is part of a false gospel, can get into church. 1 week ago, one of my daughters called. For those of you who don't know, I have 13 children, all by one wife, 13 children, 8 sons and 5 daughters. One of my daughters called within the past week to say that she and her husband have just discovered with horror that one of the co-pastors in the church they've been attending does not believe that the book of Hebrews is inspired. It all started out innocently enough when the pastor, there was one of the two co-pastors, was teaching through the Gospel of John in Sunday school. One week he finished up with John 7:53, but the next week he jumped straight to John 8:12, skipping the entire narrative about the woman taken in adultery in John 8, verses 1 through 11. A class member raised a hand and asked, why wasn't he starting with verse 1? This co-pastor replied that he did not think that that section, verses 1 through 11, was part of the original inspired text. In the discussion that followed, he also stated, well, there are other parts in our English Bibles that are not also inspired, like the book of Hebrews. Now, although this young man is fairly young and he only has an MDiv with only one class in beginning Greek and no Hebrew, he dogmatically asserted that he had studied the subject and that this was the right conclusion. My son-in-law leaned over to my daughter and whispered, "We are leaving this church." They graciously tried to follow up and tell the pastor privately that they were leaving, but a few days later he showed up on their doorstep and demanded that my daughter and her husband stop rebelling against the elders and submit to their divine authority. All the elders were in agreement with this particular co-pastor. My daughter called me in distress while the pastor was in the living room with my son-in-law, haranguing him and saying that his church was the only Bible-preaching church in the area and that they couldn't possibly find a better church that takes a literal, grammatical, historical approach to the Bible. Now, so that you won't think that this was a liberal denominational church, this was a Bible church with a history of fundamentalism. Do you understand what Satan can do to your church? Why would a pastor make this kind of major compromise? You say, what would motivate him to say these things? Well, apparently, in a nutshell, the church has a couple who are breaking up. The husband was tempted to adultery. Remember, the passage they're skipping deals with the woman taken in adultery. The husband was tempted to adultery. He apparently committed adultery. He was caught and he repented. But the wife refused to be reconciled, even though the husband begged her. Oddly, that particular husband is apparently the third man that she's had. So now she wants to get married to another man in the church, even though the couple is apparently not even divorced yet. The leaders, what are they going to do to keep peace in the church? Well, so the leaders approve of this new marriage. Ergo, you've got to skip the passage about the woman taken in adultery who repented and who was forgiven. So you've got to skip that and use the excuse it's not in the text. And in the process, this particular pastor revealed that there are other books in the Bible that he thinks are not inspired, including Hebrews. In my opinion, somebody has been asleep at the switch in that church. Many years ago, I heard a saying that is becoming clearer and clearer the older I get. Your morality will determine your theology. You want to hold on to that pet sin, you know what you're going to do? You're going to compromise other areas in the Bible to make yourself feel good. Your morality will determine your theology. Unless you are keeping short accounts with God, confessing your sins, repenting of them, turning your back on them, relying on the grace of God, not on your stupid good works, but on the grace of God, because Christ died for those sins, and you cannot continue in them. What shall we continue in sin, that grace may abound? God forbid! How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? My point. The purveyors of false theology and false gospels do not bother to infiltrate apostate churches. The devil already has them in his pocket. They infiltrate sound, fundamental, Bible preaching churches. If you're not on your guard, they will infiltrate your church as well. And yes, my son-in-law and daughter are leaving that church. So to recapitulate, elements numbers 1 and 2 concerning the person of Christ. First, the Christ of Scriptures, who is the center of the true gospel, is undiminished God, fully possessed of all the other divine attributes. Second, the Christ of Scriptures, who is the center of the true gospel, is sinless, perfect man. That brings us to the second half of the gospel of grace, the work of Christ. Just as there are two elements under the person of Christ that are part of the gospel, there are two elements under the work of Christ that are mentioned in the passages where Paul defines the gospel of grace. First, his work. The first element is his substitutionary, genuine, sacrificial death, which was proved by his burial. He was really dead. It's not like the apostate Hugh Schoenfeld has written that Jesus only swooned, that he didn't really die, he only passed out. That's a false gospel. It was proved that he died because they buried him in a tomb with a Roman guard outside and a gigantic rock that no man who had gone through what Jesus went through could have ever pushed aside. The doctrine of the substitutionary death of Christ is believed by all Bible preaching pastors, teachers, and scholars. It is a sine qua non, which means without which nothing, of the Christian faith. It's part of every Orthodox book, commentary, and tract on this subject published by true Christians. It is the shed blood of Christ in his death on the cross that accomplishes 26 things. I have all the scripture references down there, but I'm just going to read through the list. All these things are stated as being accomplished by the death of Christ on the cross and the shedding of his blood. The means of remission of sin, the foundation of the new covenant, the purchase price of the church, propitiation, which means turning aside God's wrath, the foundation for our imputed righteousness, the foundation of justification, deliverance from the wrath of God. His blood visibly is being portrayed in the Lord's table, but it does not become the Lord's blood. He died once. Contrary to what Rome teaches, that whenever the priest elevates the host and says in the words of the Mass, "We offer unto you the only true and living God," that at that moment the priest has the magical power to transubstantiate, to change the substance, though it appears the same in form. He changes the substance into the blood of Christ and the body of Christ, so that you're actually eating a piece of Jesus when you take the cracker that the priest gives. That's blasphemous heresy. The book of Hebrews, once again, tells us four times that Jesus only had to die once. It is finished, said Jesus on the cross. It's not the perpetual sacrifice of the Mass, where the Roman Catholic Church calls it a perpetual sacrifice, because there is always a priest someplace in every time zone around the world as the earth turns, where the priest is elevating the host and saying those words, "We offer unto the only true and living God." So they call it the perpetual sacrifice of Christ. Jesus died once. And because he is God, it's lasting forever. It does not have to be done again. Oh, people, you've got to believe that. The cults teach a different gospel. Back to this. Other things. That the death and blood of Christ, it's the foundation for redemption. It's the foundation for forgiveness of sins. It's key to personal communion with God. It's the source of peace with God. It's a means of reconciliation. Those are both in Colossians 1:20. It's a means of destroying the devil. Hebrews 2:14. The foundation for being our great high priest. The means of purifying our sins and our conscience. The key that gives us direct access to the presence of God. The grounds that gives Jesus the right to judge. The means of sanctification, the sign of the everlasting covenant, the foundation for election and sanctification, the foundation for both horizontal and vertical fellowship, 1 John 1:7, one of the three witnesses to the finished work of Christ, 1 John 5:8, the foundation for cleansing from sin, the source of our victory. Do you understand why the cross is so important? You have none of that if you do not have the substitutionary death of Jesus Christ. The death of Christ, particularly his shed blood, is a doctrine that the devil hates. There have been those in the modern church who have made light of the literal blood of Christ, such as Robert B. Thiem Jr. at Baraka Church in Houston, John MacArthur, much to their own peril, and much to the horror of their followers. By the way, notice how many of these elements in the list above concerning the death of Christ are found in Hebrews. Is it any surprise that the devil wants Christians to believe that Hebrews is not inspired? Second, the second key gospel element in the work of Christ is his literal bodily resurrection in the same though glorified body in which he was crucified. This, of course, is the central theme of 1 Corinthians 15, from which we derived our definition and the component parts of the gospel. In the same manner as the central theme in Romans 1, without the resurrection, we have no hope. If in this life we have hope in Christ only, we are of all men most miserable. Just like the doctrine of the death of Christ is foundational, the resurrection of Christ is repeatedly stated as the basis, the foundational basis for at least 16 major Christian doctrines throughout the New Testament. It's foundational for faith and imputation, Romans 4:24. For justification, Romans 4:25. For our new life in Christ, Romans 6:4. For guaranteed victory over death, Romans 6:9. For fruit bearing, Romans 7:4. For our own individual bodily resurrection, Romans 8:11. It's 1 Corinthians 6:14. For our salvation, for guaranteeing the truth of Scripture, for deliverance from sins, for our completely transformed and regenerated bodies, for the future reunion of believers in heaven, for application of the power of God in the church now, for the future position of believers in heaven, for our future resurrection, for the future return of Christ to deliver us from wrath, and as a proof of his genuine humanity. I know I went through that fast. I hope they're able to publish these papers because I have all of the scripture references written so that you can study this on your own. The scriptures tie these four elements concerning the person of Christ together. In both Romans 1 and 1 Corinthians 15, the final source of accurate information about Jesus Christ on each of these elements is the scriptures. Not emotions, not experience, not reason, not extra biblical texts, not papal authority or some other man-made device. The good news, the gospel, is what God has done, not what man must do to be saved. Salvation comes through faith alone in the Christ of Scriptures alone. No other Jesus can save you. So what kind of group is the Apostle Paul referring to when he says, "But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed." That statement is a reference to any group that has a different Jesus than the Christ of Scriptures. The Mormons have a different Jesus who is the brother of the devil, the child of Mary who had sex with Elohim, a Jesus who became a god with many wives to populate his own planet, just like they say you can do also. The Jehovah's Witnesses have a different Jesus who is dogmatically in their theology not God, but only a created being, Michael the Archangel, whose body evaporated into gas rather than rising from the dead. That's what Jehovah's Witnesses teach. Many of the Charismatics have a different Jesus who appears in ghostly apparitions, gives new revelation, motivates them to uncontrollable body jerking. Oh, I just watched a video, hours of that. Many different Charismatic leaders who slay people in the spirit and they begin to twitch and throw themselves all over the stage. You don't find that. That's wicked, demonic stuff. Those people are preaching a different Jesus. The Catholics have a different Jesus who is subordinate to his mother and whose work on the cross is not finished. When with Rome, you must always add something to the finished work of Christ. The finished work of Christ, remember, is part of the gospel. And the Pope himself cannot escape the flames of an imaginary purgatory before heaven, because Catholic salvation must be earned by works. Even the Muslims have a different Jesus, who was a great prophet, but inferior to Muhammad. The Hindus look at Jesus as another holy man. The Buddhists view him as an enlightened one, but declare that he himself does not provide salvation. He can only show you the method or show you the path. He's not the way. He just shows you the path of attaining salvation through enlightenment. None of those Jesuses portray the Christ of Scripture. Let him be accursed who preaches any gospel other than the gospel centered on the Christ of Scriptures. To be saved, you must trust in the Christ of Scriptures and no other Jesus. To trust in a different Jesus is to be lost and headed for a literal burning hell. The problem existed in the church in Paul's day as well as in our own, because the source of the problem is Satan. Satan is perfectly happy to use the name Jesus as long as he can fill the content of the name with a different Jesus. Paul writes about being jealous over the church at Corinth, that he wants to present them as a chaste virgin to Christ, and he says, but I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. Who is Jesus? What did Jesus do? He's God and man. He died for your sins and was buried and rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. The Christ of Scriptures. And so that's why Paul continues, if he cometh that preacheth another Jesus whom we have not preached, or you receive another spirit which ye have not received, or another gospel which you have not accepted, there's danger. He's writing to a church of believers. They had definite problems in that church. They were weak sheep, easily tempted. But he also warned the church at Ephesus. Did you know that? And that's one of the strongest churches in the New Testament. The apostates, the people who come in preaching another gospel, they externally appear to be Christians. Some of them even call themselves apostles and Christian workers. But they have a twisted gospel promoted by the devil himself. It's a false gospel because it's not based on the finished work of Christ. It's a gospel that mixes works and experience and human authority and demonic supernaturalism and extra-biblical revelation with the Bible, or it promotes those deviations as a substitute for the Christ of Scriptures. So we need to ask ourselves the question, where do these devil-empowered frauds come from? The Bible also gives the answer to that question. Listen to Paul's farewell address to the Ephesian elders in Acts 20. Paul's about to go to Rome. He'll never see them again. Now behold, I know that you all, among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God, shall see my face no more. This is Acts chapter 20, beginning in verse 25. Wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men, for I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Therefore take heed unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God, now I love this next phrase, which he hath purchased with his own blood. God purchased the church with his own blood. That means Jesus is God. That's what Paul just said there. For this I know, that after my departing shall, here's the first category, Paul tells us where they're coming from, grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Category 2, also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone, night and day, with tears. Imagine that. Some of the elders who actually gathered that day to listen to Paul's farewell speech would be among the wolves that would shred the flock. Those were men who had trained under the ministry of the very man whom God used to write most of the New Testament. And this was not the only time Paul had warned the church at Ephesus. He had constantly warned them of this threat night and day with tears for full 3 years. Now, if that particular threat was so intensely dangerous to the church at Ephesus, one of the strongest churches in the New Testament, we should obviously heed Paul's warning here. Such false teachers do not openly proclaim their apostate doctrines when they first come to a church. They start attending. They get a feel for the water. They make pious professions, You know, they do helpful things. They participate in the activities. They gradually take lesser responsibilities, and as people begin to trust them, they move into higher positions of authority. But they are deceivers with an agenda. Jude warns about them in verse 4, "For there are certain men crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ." Did you get that? They creep in when nobody is looking for them. Nobody's expecting them. And they do two things. Number one, remember we're talking about the gospel of grace. Number one, they redefine grace to mean the right to engage in unrestrained lust. And number two, they deny the person and work of Christ, which we've just talked about. You know, when a church has been at peace for a long time, the believers, and often the pastors, get lulled to sleep because everything seems to be going so smoothly and well. But remember a key illustration of carelessness that God gives in the Bible and the clear methodologies of those who preach another gospel. You'll have to read this passage on your own, because I'm not going to have time for it tonight. I've got 4 minutes left. But it's in Judges chapter 18. Read Judges 18. You'll discover that the children of Dan sent their family, 5 men, to go spy out the country and to search it and look for a place for the Danites to land. And they came to Laish, where the people were very careless, where they were quiet and insecure. There was no magistrate in the land to put them to shame. They were far from the Zidonians. They had no business with any man. In other words, they were out there floating along, peaceful, and having their own way. And along the way, the Danites, coming to attack this city, picked up a young Levite with an ephod, a teraphim, a graven image, a molten image, who was working as the personal priest of a man by the name of Micah. So with the encouragement of this false religious leader, loaded with false gods, they made their attack and they conquered the city of Laish. Galatians 1 warns that ghastly gospel ghouls and putrid, perverted preachers with a false gospel, very much like those spies, slip into the church unnoticed. First, notice that they're spies. They're looking for something that will benefit them and the kingdom that they represent. That's the whole point of being a spy. They're not looking for something that will benefit you and your church. They're looking for a way to get something for themselves and their dark overlord. If your church has a nice piece of property and other assets, you will have people checking you out to see if you're a soft target like the people of Laish. That's happened to me a number of times in the ministry. Let me tell you about one that happened about 3 weeks ago. Most recently, I looked out into our parking lot and I saw a gold Cadillac SUV, an Armada. Very expensive, fancy car. It was parked behind the church with 2 men looking the church over. So as I always do, I walked over to the unknown vehicle. I identified myself as the pastor and I asked, "May I help you?" Both of the men looked strongly Middle Eastern. One of the men said, "You must be just the person we need to talk to." And then they told me their names, Nabil and Kouri. Those are both Arabic names, which confirmed my suspicion. "Word is out on the street that the church is for sale," one of them said. "No," I said emphatically. "In fact, in just a few hours, we'll be starting our annual winter youth rally with about 70 young people coming. And we hold regular services throughout the week." And then I listed all the activities. And then I asked, "Who told you that the church was for sale?" They evaded the question and just said, "Well, you know, word is out on the street." So I gave each of them a gospel track calendar. I have 2,000 calendars printed up. It has 2017 on the front, but it's got the gospel on the back. So I gave each one of them a gospel track calendar and they drove off. Now I wonder, is there some group looking for a prime piece of real estate to build a mosque? I don't know. But I do know that it's always wise to be on the alert to things that might happen. When I first came to the church, I warned the elders and the trustees that it would be a very wise idea to tighten up the membership requirements, since the church is not only a spiritual body, but we have legal obligations for real estate and money that's been entrusted to us by God. I got some opposition from the idea. I was told that, well, ever since we started the church, The policy has been the gate to church membership is as wide as the gate to heaven. So if someone claimed to be a Christian, they were allowed to become a member on the spot. I suppose that if you have a very large group of poor people, that might be a deterrent for someone to come in and try to take over your property. But if you're a small group of people, suppose, for example, that a group of charismatics looking for a piece of church property decided to slowly infiltrate, join the church, and then, when they had enough votes, vote the current leadership out and take over the church, and it wouldn't cost them a dime. That piece of church property is worth $8 million. We appear to have had that problem of infiltration on other occasions with visitors who came, viewed the congregation, sat through the services, some several times, but who refused to give their names or addresses on the follow-up cards for a letter or visit. That happened within the last month. Over the past 2 weeks, we've had a visitor who also had strong Middle Eastern appearance. The second week, he brought his wife with him, but they refused to give more than their first names and refused to stay for a fellowship dinner where people might have gotten to know them better. That's number one. Second thing about the spies who creep in, I'm 2 minutes over time. Can I have enough time to go through 4 points? And I'll be done? Where's Stephen? Okay, may I? Okay. Stephen said it's okay. People that Paul curses for bringing in false gospels are spies. They use the techniques of deception, infiltration. They cover up and they have a covert attack. Second, notice that when they come in peacefully. Most pastors are always excited to see new people coming into their churches. When the five spies came into Laish, they didn't come in waving their swords and screaming, "We are going to kill you!" They probably came in dressed like travelers or businessmen or something else. They looked very ordinary. They probably didn't come in as a group. They probably came in one at a time or in pairs. They did not attract attention to themselves. Third, notice that they picked up false gods along the way with a religious leader who had no discernment concerning the true God, but who was very excited to work for a larger group and make more money than he was currently making. That's especially true in the charismatic movement, where there is a constant overbearing focus on what's called the prosperity gospel. If you just give the false gospel prophet enough money, you'll be rich and healthy yourself. Fourth, notice that when they finally come to take over, they came back with force and with enough people to grab everything that they wanted without too much structure. I have other stories that I could tell you. I wish I had time. A group that tried to take over the church that I was an assistant pastor of 40 years ago. My father was the senior pastor. They claimed that the Shekinah glory had appeared to them in a vision. A ball of fire had showed up and told them they were supposed to take over the church. One Sunday, they marched into the church, right down the center aisle. 75 people marched down the center aisle of the church and demanded that my father leave the pulpit, that they were taking over the church because God had told them through the Shekinah glory to take over the church. Well, the church was a corporation. It was a legal corporation, and it had bylaws as to when you could call congregational meetings to vote on things like that. They had to have 2 weeks, so 2 weeks went by. The meeting gathered. They realized they'd been going around infiltrating, trying to grab people to pull them over onto their side. They realized at the meeting they didn't have quite enough, so one young man stood up. The man who started this was an elder in that church. He had worked his way up to being an elder in the church. Everybody trusted him. They had no idea that this was going on. The Bible studies that he was holding, where he was taking new Christians and sucking them into that kind of stuff. Young man who was the son of that guy stood up. "We need to pray about it more." An old lady in the church whose name was Mrs. Means, and she was a tough one. She took her cane and she shook it right in his face and said, "Young man, we've prayed long enough. You sit down." He sat down. They voted, and the fireball people left. The sad thing is they went and split 4 other churches in San Antonio. But God, in his grace, spared Grace Bible Church, the next people. There were more people in that church than had been when those apostates were there. So I end with 7 questions. When was the last time you warned your church about the nice people in the church who were bringing in worldly, carnal, or demonic elements into the worship, theology, or practice of your young people, or your young married couples, or your older groups for that matter? Have you warned them about those? Number 2, do you know what's going on behind the scenes with other leaders in your church? As I just told you, years ago in the church where I served as the assistant pastor, a trusted elder held so-called Bible studies at his home to seduce many young Christians into speaking in tongues, ecstatic visions of the Shekinah glory. Those people split the church. What teaching materials have the subordinate leaders brought in for your Sunday school classes young people and children? Who are the publishers? What do those materials teach about the Genesis account of creation, the crossing of the Red Sea, the flood of Noah? Almost all the compromising Sunday school literature goes wobbly on at least one of those three areas. Number four, what kind of activities do your subordinate leaders sponsor that will sustain the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, or the pride of life? Who knows, maybe somebody listening to me today has already slid into the slime pit of those three deadly sins and is dragging others in the church down. Number five, what kind of music are they using in the youth group or in so-called outreach? Does it imitate the pagan world and the music used to attract demons in jungle tribes? This is one of the most serious areas of the attack of the devil today. This morning I talked to you about how God is a musical being. He sings over those whom he loves. But Satan is a gifted musical being according to Ezekiel 28 and Isaiah 14. There are specific musical instruments mentioned as being built into Satan himself. And Satan wants music to glorify himself rather than to glorify God. I'm doing a series on that in the church in Collingswood because I believe that the ungodly Baal worship music used in many neo-evangelical churches has the ultimate goal of watering down the true gospel of Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Number six, are there any of the leaders and role models in your church teaching the young people that it is permissible to follow the clothing standards of the unregenerate world? Number seven, what specifically are they teaching or failing to teach and modeling or failing to model about the holiness of sex as it is reserved for marriage? Have they taken any stands on that? Sex is not dirty. Sex is holy. And that's why we treat it with such honor and respect. It only belongs in the context of marriage. And not only young people, but older people are tempted in this area. So the three types that are going to attack you, and they'll attack in those areas. I just left the seven areas. Wolves from outside the flock who attack the weak sheep, straggling too far from the shepherd. Wolves come from the outside, they'll seek to bring the world into the church. Traitors who are hiding in the middle of the flock, like the guy I told you about with the fireball that he saw. Men and women who are out of divine order, who will attack from inside, pretending to be spiritual Bible teachers. They'll seek to stimulate the flesh. The devil and the demons who will use both wolves and traitors to bring in demonic doctrine and practice to destroy the real Christ, the separated stand of the church, and the moral purity of believers. I wish I had time to go into the context. It's the book of Galatians. Grace contrasted to law, faith contrasted to works, spirit contrasted to flesh, liberty contrasted to bondage. But the gospel is who Jesus is and what he did. He's both God and man, sinless, perfect man, unreduced God. He died for your sins. He was buried and rose the third day. And it's all according to the scriptures. The devil will attack the Bible because he wants to deny the Christ of scriptures. He wants to bring in a different gospel, but only the Christ of scriptures can save. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for your word and for its power. How we thank you for the way that day by day you are working in our hearts and lives to conform us to the image of Christ. Father, we pray that you will protect each of the churches represented here at this Congress. The devil doesn't attack the apostate churches. He just has fun manipulating them. But he attacks and undermines those that are Bible-believing churches, those that are clear in their faith, those who are presenting the gospel of Christ, those who are teaching salvation by grace through faith alone, those who want to glorify God and not him. And he's very jealous of the glory that God gets. And so he will bring in whatever he can to turn the glory to himself. We thank you, Father, for your word. I pray that it will not return to you void, but that it will accomplish that which you please, and that it will prosper in the thing we're